Hi, and welcome to The Tomato Timer, a podcast about learning to learn. I'm Z from Zenos, and I'm tuning in live with experts around the world asking your questions and hearing their stories, all before the timer goes off. 24 minutes and 39 seconds to go. I'd like to introduce today to our episode, Juliana, who has been my mentor when I was in the launch program with UCL Innovation and Enterprise. And she's like an amazing award-winning entrepreneur and a champion for women in entrepreneurship. And we're so excited to have you. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Zubair, for a very kind introduction. Thank you for having me.
No, it's just amazing. So like, you know, our format for the past couple of days, we've had our channel open and getting some questions in. But before we get started with those, I kind of wanted to know a bit more about kind of your history about getting into entrepreneurship. How did it all start? Where were you studying, and how did it lead to you becoming so into this kind of area of the world?
Sure. Well, it started when I was actually quite young. My father used to run a family business which specialized in recycling color metals like nickel, copper, aluminium. And actually from the age of 10, I was seeing what's going on as a small business when he's trying to grow for very sort of beginning by himself. And looking the hard side and a good side of the business, and actually working within the business from an early age. So straight after the school, I will go to the office and help out where I can with the paperwork or sort of things that the company needs. And one thing which really was, I think now I can see the benefits of that, is that my father always see the family side and the business side are completely two different things. So when we're coming home, everything is great. We're family, we're together, we're talking about it. But when you're actually working in the business, when you're in the office, he is very strict. He sees the mistakes, he asks the questions. So it's been a real sort of experience of the harsh side, seeing the real world business. And it wasn't always pleasant at that time, but now I can see how beneficial it was then. When I came to the UK and went to study at my first degree at Thames Valley University, which is now University of West London, I've done business studies degree. I always, in the back of my mind, I always wanted to do something for myself, work for myself. Yeah. And I tried a few things. I found out about Entrepreneur Society within the university. I joined that. I became a president. I tried to enter as many competitions as I could possibly find around entrepreneurship and learn from the best and network with people. So it's always been sort of a huge interest in me of how it works. When I came to the UK, it also been an amazing to see how much support is available in the UK in terms of the whole ecosystem, you know, in terms of the training and support and mentoring and specialized network. It's been quite an overwhelming, actually.
Yeah.
It's gone from then, really.
Yeah. Even when I got to uni, it was amazing. Like, I hadn't really explored this option much, but when I got to the societies at uni, there are so many people out there who are very welcoming and giving lots of great advice to you at any stage of whatever, like, startup or business idea you have. It actually comes up to the first question that was asked by one of the guys here. What, like, because different people have different perspectives of what business entails. Sometimes it's seen as a very selfish pursuit as well. And it's kind of tough because, from different cultures, it's seen differently. What is it for you? Obviously, it's quite different in the UK, but how can we justify why business is such an amazing thing to pursue and, like, make people understand why it has such a positive impact?
Sure. We'll actually look at the two sides of that, which is quite interesting from my personal story as well. First of all, the small business is the gold of any economy. And actually, if you see statistics around the world nowadays, majority of the businesses out there are small and micro businesses. If you take UK itself, 99.6 businesses are small, medium enterprises. So it's become a driven force of actually economic development around the world. Lots of things influence that, of course, the technology, the, you know, the adaptation, how we actually do the work and do the business nowadays. But it is becoming a center of economic development. But the starting a business, yes, you know, there's sort of two sides to it. There's a necessity and an opportunity. You can see an opportunity and jump on it, and see, well, actually, I can make lots of money from it and do this and this. But very often we see entrepreneurship, it actually comes from necessity. And in my case, with my actual social enterprise I've been running for the last 6 years, that's what it has been. So if I give you a little bit of background, I used to have an amazing job, really, as I thought at that time. I got married, I got a child, so everything was going perfectly well.
Yeah.
But when my daughter was born, I went back to my employer and trying to find the ways I can work more flexibly or actually be able to look after my daughter and also do my work really well, which I'm passionate about.
Yeah.
And that wasn't the case. So suddenly I had a choice. I had to leave because the money I was making doesn't really make any commercial sense for me going back and not seeing my daughter and not being able to spend time with her and have no money. So I had to look into myself, all the experience I had with my family business, what I studied at university, the networks I engage with, what is out there in the community I can use to use my skills differently and actually see if I can, you know, set up a social enterprise supporting other people. So The initial social enterprise, my outspace, which was a business center with the childcare provision and business support, was actually driven by the necessity within my situation.
Yeah.
So I think there's a two side to the story. Yes, more businesses are great, but in a lot of economies, it's driven by necessity because the job market is different. It's hard to find work. And even if you find work, it's no longer work for life. You have to be constantly selling yourself, constantly adapting, changing things, learning new things. So the whole environment is kind of forcing you to be more entrepreneur driven in your mindset.
I was just, I remember a stat I was hearing a couple of days ago, is that I think the small and medium sized enterprises in the UK are making more than 50%, around 60% worth of jobs in the UK. Is that
absolutely?
So yeah. Even in the case of that, like we're these little things that we think are, you know, family driven businesses and smaller enterprises, we don't really aren't they're not the big flashy names we know all over the world, but these are the places where more than half of the population is actually working at, earning from and living their life with. So it is so important for there to be people to run businesses like these. And so, yeah, absolutely. It's very hard to find. Obviously, there's greed in every industry, but it's hard to find like why, you know, there's so much negativity associated to going out to study and starting a business. So another question I wanted to go on to is, how did your parents react to this kind of choice of moving away from a very steady, kind of comfortable, kind of foreseeable perspectives and job to something much more experimental? How did, and what about yourself and your family? It wasn't not kind of scary to like leave something that was so like, you know, driven and had foundations already?
My parents wanted to be an accountant because they thought if I'll be an accountant, I'll be the best person for the home, for the family business. And I can go back and support the family business. But it's been always, my parents and my father has a military background, and it's always been, you know, very structured, very focused way of how I do things. And I've always been restricted in what I would like to do. So it has to be always been prescribed to me. And when I came to the UK, I realized that I'm actually away from that environment. And I realized how many opportunities out there. And we had a lot of different conversations with my parents, of course. They wanted me to come back. But I had to make sort of harsh choices. And I said, well, actually, this is my future. I will make choices as I see. So, yeah, they wanted me to be an accountant. I'm not an accountant. And I will never be. It's not in my heart at all. And actually, when I started the business, they kind of been a bit skeptical. And my dad says, yeah, we'll try a few things, see how it goes. And actually, he did not believe it will work. So, you know, he thought, I'm just doing it for a bit of a fun and see how it is.
Yeah.
But actually, he, as the business developed and have done really well, he took it more seriously. And the conversations we had down the line were a completely different conversation from what it was when I just started. And no support was given by my parents for the business. And I'm fine with that because I think they just wanted me to, okay, if you want to try, you go and try it by yourself how it is. Yeah, there's been quite difficult conversations. But I just had to make a choices and, yeah.
And it's led you where you are. So another kind of like question regarding academics. You have you hold a PhD in, is it exactly business or something more specific? And what inspired you to pursue, you know, after being an entrepreneur? Lots of like entrepreneurs kind of forget about academics. They don't even try to get their university degrees. What made you like passionate about continuing academics?
Sure. If you tell me 10 years ago, Juliana, you'll have a PhD, I will laugh at you. I never planned to become a doctor and I never planned to study this long. When I studied my undergraduate degree, University of West London, Business Studies. Then I had a scholarship with Kingston University to do my Master's in Business Studies and Research. And at that point, I said, that's it. I've studied the business and I'm going to just explore the world, make it happen and, you know, do it by practice. But then I've always been connected to the world of academia because I'll be always coming back and do some lecturing, some program development, because the business side was around startup development. So I've always been within the ecosystem of business agencies, support organizations, as well as universities.
Yeah.
And being within that world, I contributed to some research around entrepreneurship. I contributed to lots of different reports around migrant entrepreneurship, female entrepreneurship. And then one day I saw this ad, which is asking, would you like to do a PhD in entrepreneurship, scholarship with my old university, University of West London? And it was very flexible how it's been written, what the focus, entrepreneurship is the focus, but what exactly, you know, which part of entrepreneurship, what exactly they want to go to. And I said, you know what? I don't think I will ever give, you know, there is a reason why I see this ad at this time. Because I've been doing the research, I've been doing the business, I've been involved within their ecosystem. I can see it from three-dimensional perspective, what entrepreneurship means.
Yeah.
And I decided to apply. I put my application in and I was invited to the interview. I got to the interview and there was quite a few people shortlisted. And the whole interview, I was talking about the business experience I had in the last year since I finished my master's. And next day, I got a call and I said, I got accepted on PhD. And I was like, wow, that's really, you know, it's kind of amazing because you got on the program. But then you said, okay, this is actually a serious thing. I have to do it for 3 years. And I have to, you know, and I have to do it well. And when I had my first meeting with potential supervisors, they said, okay, which side do you want to discuss? What would you like to do? And I got a bit lost because I thought it will be quite prescriptive because it's funded. It's, you know, PhD usually structured things. And I was very lucky that they actually made it quite open. So my research was focusing actually on being myself as international students and seeing lots of international students in the UK, research was focusing on what's the impact on business education in the UK on international students and what do they do with it when they go back home to their home countries. So actually looking how the ecosystem and the knowledge and educational system impacts basically future entrepreneurs around the world. And I thought that just fits perfectly well with the business, what I'm passionate about, what I want to do. And I can study more about it. But of course, what I haven't realized how challenging the PhD journey is. PhD is great, but within the program, it's not all about what you do, what you enjoy. I absolutely enjoy the actual research part. It's talking to people, collecting the data, looking at the data and how fascinating the results were.
Yeah.
But the actual writing in academic style, practical stuff, I hated it. Absolutely hated it. So you have to be prepared for, you know, it's a commitment, but you've got to make sure it makes a difference for yourself at the end, not for institution. You know, how it actually impacts the world. How do you contribute to the knowledge, but also the practical side of how the world works? That's so important.
Amazing. So
to keep you motivated. Yeah.
The inspiration was an advert and somehow getting accepted in like a day's worth of a call or something.
The inspiration was actually seeing in a particular time when I had so much experience in academia and business and as an entrepreneur student. So it's all sort of coming together. And I just thought, you know, I don't think I will see another opportunity like this.
Tell me a bit about because you've been working with the kind of the startup ecosystem for so long. You've seen it transform quite a bit as well. what's the current kind of situation, and not only just like the UK one, because you have perspective from the international ecosystem, and what is it like for international students who are coming to study at uni, and how are they getting engaged and affected by it?
Yes, UK's entrepreneurship ecosystem is very strong. It's a bit overwhelmed. Even in the UK, you need to know where to go and what information to trust and consider. Around the world is building up momentum. Obviously, the States been ahead of UK, and it's another huge ecosystem which well connects with UK and sort of European countries. But outside that circle, things are not as advanced as you will see in the UK. But there's a lot of buzz around entrepreneurship. And actually, you know, entrepreneurship means a lot of things. It's not just to set up your own business. It's being entrepreneurial, your mindset, and how you approach everything in your life. So it's great to see, for example, I do lots of work in Russia. And the business, even the business education entrepreneurship is very new to the Russia. You know, it's in the last 30, 40 years when sort of things started actually formally being introduced in the universities. But you see accelerators, you see incubators, you see enterprise competitions. So you see more and more things of encouraging people to consider entrepreneurship as a sort of a career path and develop their skills. Earlier, I've been in Egypt in April this year, and we visited a couple accelerator programs and universities. And you see how much emphasis has also started to be given to sort of developing an enterprise culture, enterprise mindset, and to the entrepreneurship within their education system, and creating sort of micro ecosystems. They're not very well connected, but it's a starting point. You've got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
And if somebody, wherever you are around the world, I think it's important to really search for things, look for things like an incubator or accelerator, look at the government, a lot of government around the world, and I mean Caribbean, everywhere else, developing programs as we speak. So just be really open to what entrepreneurship means and just explore the opportunity, see what's out there where you are. There's a lot of things online. I mean, we run an online virtual incubator in the SAY School, and there's a lot of other places where you can engage with our experts, you get mentoring support, and just to see if that's something for you. There's a huge development of ecosystem across the world, which is great to see.
So you kind of mentioned it very passingly, and I want to know a bit more about the SAY Business School, and like a bit more, because a lot of our kind of community is interested in looking at business, and we come from all over the world, and sometimes an international education is quite difficult to manage, to afford without scholarships and other financial support. So can you tell us a bit more about what that's, I know a bit, so tell the community how it's all shaped up.
Sure. So SAY School of Business been actually born from the problem you just mentioned, particularly working with a lot of international students. So what it does, it provides the affordable and accessible path to UK education, but with the main focus around business management and applied entrepreneurship, because the school really believes learning by doing, learning by exploring, engaging with the real world information, trying things out in a safe environment to make it work. Mm-hmm. And the way it's been set up, that the students can do equivalent of the first and second year of university degree with the SAY School of Business online, and complete the final year of their bachelor degree with one of the partners of the SAY School of Business. So there are currently 20 different partners across the UK, and you get the final bachelor degree of that university. But also, if you join on a degree, you will get a free access to the virtual incubator, which is part of the SAY School of Business. So you'll get if you have a business idea or would like to explore what entrepreneurship means to you, we have a bank of mentors, a learning program, and support to explore that and see if that's something you would be interested to develop further. We're also working very closely with Department of International Trade, another organization, which are actually very interested to see if international community has good ideas, particularly within the tech world. And there is an opportunity to get support in terms of the visa and other support to bring your ideas into the UK and actually establish business in the UK.
Amazing.
But yes, the State School of Business is focusing on those two areas, and it basically provides something which really saves you money and saves time and gives you the high quality of education.
A British degree at the end of it, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, amazing.
So some of the universities we work with are Coventry University, Manchester, Lincoln, Nottingham University. So they're really good universities. Yeah. And you get degree of that particular university.
And the first 2 years, like, how does the remote learning process work? Because it might feel a bit lonely for all alone without, because it's nice to, you know, go to uni with friends and stuff. So how have you been developed that?
Sure. So we're using one of the systems which a lot of universities use for online materials. So you get access to all the reading you need, all the materials. You got a personal tutor which guides you through the process. And we build a community. So you will be able to communicate with other people in the program, wherever the part of the world they are, engage with them, sort of support each other, create a peer-to-peer support group. All the assignments, because they're focusing on this particular two areas, business management and applied entrepreneurship, all the assignments are written assignments, essays, reflective essays, reports. So there is no examination. So it's really trying to explore their issues, understand the practical implementation of the solution you create, and help you to go through the journey by using academic tools and, you know, latest research. But there's definitely... It is a challenge to study online. It's a commitment, but there is a supportive community from the university perspective, but also from the student's perspective.
And there is
one more thing. So if you are committed, depending on personal circumstances, and able to put forward a full-time sort of, you know, really focus on your studies, you actually can complete two academic years within one calendar year. So wow. If you really want to, you get your degree as quick as possible, you focus, you concentrate it, you know, you want to do it, the one mm-hmm. academic year can be completed within 6 months.
Wow. Well, that's an accelerated degree.
Yeah.
That's 2 years, right? Like, so if we...
Yeah, so that... 1 year. Yeah, so 2 years with State School of Business can actually be completed within the one calendar year. And then you can study the final year with the university partner. And some of our partners offer also online solutions, or you're welcome to come to the UK. We'll support you with your application for visa to make sure you're able to come mm-hmm. and complete the final year on campus.
Amazing. And it's I would like still recommend if we could get there, like to come and have that kind of experience, to be with people and go to university and have that campus experience. But this is a much more affordable way of doing it all, because I know how expensive it is to. Even a year worth of international studies actually adds up to quite a lot.
Yes, yeah. I mean, it really depends on circumstances. And yeah. We all have different reasons for coming and what we are able to commit financially and time-wise. So, yeah, it's just a different option to make it more flexible for people to achieve what they want to achieve.
Absolutely. So, Juliana, as you know, we are quite tight in our timings. We like yeah. to do that whole pom clock. So we're almost at 25 minutes. I'd just like to have your last couple of words for anyone, not just pursuing business, but in general, like your either a saying or a motto or a thing you live by for our community to hear from you.
Sure. I think I will say one thing. There is never a right time to start a business. It's like there is never a right time to get married or have a baby, as I found out. So if you have an idea, yes, there might be financial restrictions. There might be other sort of things which are stopping you from making that final decision. Go for it. But you don't have to do the whole idea straight away. You can break it down in small projects, but do something. Start somewhere and see what type of response you get. Because mm-hmm. longer we sit on it, longer we think about it, unfortunately, quicker we lose that opportunity, particularly yeah. in the current environment. So if you have an idea, I will be more than happy to offer a conversation to anybody who's on this channel today, to sort of offer half an hour of mentoring, to discuss the business idea if they have one. But you've got to do something about it to see if it's feasible. Try it out. But please don't just keep it away from actual practical implementation. Go for it. That will be my main advice.
Amazing. Thank you so much for being here. I think our community loved this. And we still have a couple of questions which are pinging around. But if you have your minutes, you can have a look at in our found it amazing, very inspirational. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
Bye-bye.